Welcome back to Rush Hour. My name is Mubarak Mugabo. We are still discussing the progress in the fight against corruption in Uganda. And of course, with me is Dr. Patricia Achan-Okiria, the Deputy Inspector of Government, Inspector General of Government. And of course, we want to look at certainly the progress now that has been made after talking about the National Assembly. Doctor, let's move away, let's broaden it beyond the parliament, because it looks like there are many other issues outside the National Assembly. Why is Uganda still ranking high in terms of corruption index? Because the recently that came out from Transparency International, it looks like we are not in any way doing better. What is the cause?
Well, when you look at Transparency International, of course the ranking affects us also, because we find ourselves working extremely hard and instituting measures to deal with corruption.
Yes.
But each time, like now this past year, when the Mabati scandal happened and several other scandals of goats, I don't know, rats and others, you find that the reports Transparency International relies on for their sources of information is basically arising from those occurrences. So much as we have, as an anti-corruption agency, put in a lot of efforts, we will still rank even much lower. And going forward, like, our strategy is now to deal with the big fish. When we begin tackling the big fish, and reports come out of, you know, the big fish, they're now prosecuting cases involving big shots, so we will even rank much lower, because the levels of corruption, the perception. So I think perceptions come due to the sources of data Transparency International relies on. For instance, when we have scandals like the Mabati, the goats, and others, perceptions are likely to be bad.
Yeah.
But as an institution, we are working together with citizens on this. That's why you heard us talking about the citizens' war against corruption, because we know that this is a citizens' thing. The people need to be involved. And as an institution, we need to devise a mechanism of giving feedback to the people on the progress. Just like when you go to war, Mubarak, you have to be equipped with the tools. You have to, first of all, know the enemy very well. We have to scope the enemy. So our responsibility as an institution now is to train the citizens, equip them, give them information so that they are able to come out and demand for accountability from an informed perspective, because they have the information. As an institution, that is what we intend to do. And then we also want to give clarity by way of feedback, progress in the war against corruption. As an institution, we want the institution to know the challenges we're going through and how we can work together with citizens to push this war further. And this is through feedback, because the fight against corruption, like we say, it is a citizens' war, because they are the victims of corruption. And then the enemies of progress will always come up with those bad allegations against the country and the institutions. So when you look at the data, the sources of data Transparency International relies on, it's from research. Independent researchers, individuals,
operating within
our country. Like, a researcher can come from the UK and say, well, there are scandals here, and write things down. And that is what Transparency International relies on. So as Ugandans, I think, need a message of hope in the war against corruption, something to give them hope so that they know that they will own this war against corruption and know that together we can make a difference.
How much does your office, for example, save Ugandan money? How much does it save in the fight against corruption on an annual basis?
In the fight against corruption, we have got an asset recovery fund where we do get recoveries from our recommendations, from our orders out there. We save approximately, like, if I look at what transpired last year, between July, we recovered about 400 million. August, we recovered 134 million. September, 455. August, October 255 million. But it is true that as IG we save government that money that is being stolen out there through our enforcement mechanisms and ensuring that the corrupt officials do not get back to enjoy the proceeds of corruption or the fruits of their corruption. So we have set targets to ensure that we at least recover 100 billion annually. But progressively, we are getting there. In our targets, we have a fully established asset recovery unit with a mandate to recover property or money that has been illicitly acquired. We have also established the Inspectorate of Government Compliance Unit, and this unit specifically does follow up on our recommendations, on our orders in the whole country. So when I look at financial year 2022-2023, as an IG, we recovered a total of about 14 billion from orders issued for recovery, and a cash payment of 6.1 billion and property worth 8.7 billion. So when we look at that, and that comes the asset recovery fund and goes back to the consolidated fund, we have made big strides, but as you know, that recovery is also progressive. That's why when I was sharing with you, you see the fluctuations. Mm. We've gotten 400, we've gotten 134, we've gotten this through the recovery. So it is, we have made strides, but it is also progressive in nature. We cannot say we recover what can cover our budget, because remember, we always need supplementary budget to substitute or improve or add to what it is we can do as an IG. But we are also struggling resource-wise, much as we are recovering. But we need money to be plowed into those recoveries. Mm. We need money to facilitate people to go up country to do follow-up. We have got 16 regional offices, but are they resourced enough? So the war against corruption, I think, need a special budget. A special budget.
So that's when capacity comes in. That's what I was asking you about.
Investigating
people if we receive a complaint,
are we able to swing into action? We talk about detecting and quick fixing. But if I don't have manpower, how am I going to do timely investigations? So I think it's important for the IG to get support. Support from the government of Uganda, resource-wise, so that we are able to recruit, we are able to strengthen operations in the regional offices, we are able to implement those strategies.
Looking at the recent investigations that you have been doing as your office, what are the most forms of corruption that you have certainly interfaced with?
Well, corruption changes faces like an amoeba. We have had cases of bribery. I think you can see the headlines where we did that operation in Bugiri. Mm. Sometimes it's a syndicate where you see officials in government or local government do a plan amongst themselves. Mm. Sometimes it's in the area of procurement where you see corruption by conduit, order from above, and so on. So our office has got to derive new innovative mechanisms of dealing with it. And I can tell you it is very hard to prove a case of bribery unless I have set a trap, unless I can prove that you solicited for it, because it happens behind scenes.
Yeah.
So we need new innovative approaches in dealing with this complexity of corruption. Corruption takes various forms and occurs. People cover. It's hard to detect. Sometimes without extensive investigations or efforts, it becomes difficult for us. So we rely on reports of whistleblowers, for instance. We rely on reports from the community monitoring groups, those who monitor government projects at the grassroots, because corrupt practices may involve like collusion or multiple individuals or sophisticated schemes or manipulations. So you find that as the Inspectorate of Government, we keep thinking and rethinking, what strategy can we use? What approach? That's why you find that before we even arrest, sometimes we have to do clandestine investigations, and then we even set traps and manage to get people. Then there's a problem of lack of transparency, making it difficult to access information, relevant information we need to have a case prosecuted. Mm. It becomes difficult to access suspicious activities in the institutions and even hold the perpetrators accountable. So you find that corruption has got its complexities, and that's the reason why as an institution, we need to come up with new innovations. And that is why you hear we are coming up with a lifestyle audit, we are doing barazas.
Oh, the president told you not to stop, to go slowly.
Well, the president did make a comment on that, but the lifestyle audit per se is a very, very important anti-corruption tool because it's a new investigative approach where you study somebody's behavior, mannerism, and lifestyle over a period of time to be able to verify whether he acquired whatever it is he has illicitly or he got it through the normal channel. So, but we're talking about the challenges we have. We have resource constraints, which we have talked about, delayed or which delays our investigations sometimes. So we need to take to address these challenges in order to improve efficiency and effectiveness of the institution. We need to be adequately facilitated and resourced in order to be able to foster, first of all, public awareness and engagement in order to empower the citizens to demand for accountability. We need to do outreach and go out there. So I think for me, that is how I would address that question, Mubarak. But as an institution, we have got a lot of zeal. We have got power within the law. We have got the human resource. We have got people who are competent to conduct investigations, but they're not sufficient.
You may have the power in the law, but the practice may certainly turn out to be different.
Yes, yes.
Last time I saw, you know, everybody saw the president certainly warning your office about the lifestyle audit.
Well,
and of course he brought out an aspect that certainly would look at corruption to have some good element of corruption, some good corruption and bad corruption. Do you appreciate these theories within your office?
When you look at the lifestyle audit, like I said, it's a very important tool in the war against corruption. For detecting illicit enrichment, we look at it as an investigative approach, first of all. It helps to uncover instances of corruption among the public officials. When the president made that comment, he did not say it in bad faith. He said, well, the people will go and invest out, but we have got mechanisms of picking out the people from out. We have got partnership and strategic alliances. We have got the mutual legal assistance. We have got collaborations with the African anti-corruption authorities, with the East African anti-corruption authorities within the region. So the president did make a comment, but did not discourage or obstruct the lifestyle audit because the president actually launched it. We have his signature. He launched it. And the president has given us a lot of support. So when we build on that, Mubarak, I think it sends a bad message that there are limits to scrutiny of public officials, and this will basically undermine the efforts to promote transparency within our institution, to promote even accountability. But fortunately, the office of the IG is having a lot of support from the branches of government, including the executive. And I want to assure all our viewers out there that there is a commitment from government leadership to uphold the rule of law. There's a commitment to support anti-corruption efforts without undue interference. Because remember, we started by saying we have the mandate. The law gives us the powers.
So even additionally, when the president says go slow, he does not really stop you from conducting audit.
He doesn't stop. The president swore us into office, gave us the power, and we have got the law. We have got the legal framework, and the law has been strengthened, by the way. We now have guidelines on lifestyle audit to empower the office to conduct our duties independently without any fear of reprisal. So this includes ensuring that the lifestyle audits are conducted very well in accordance with the due process of the law, respecting people's rights, individual rights, while being effective in, of course, uncovering the corrupt activities that may be happening. So there are no restrictions whatsoever placed on our ability as the Inspectorate of Government to conduct the lifestyle audit. Because if there are interferences, it would definitely impede our operations as the Inspectorate of Government, and it would affect our mandate to hold public officials accountable and root out corruption.
The reason why we are seeing that it might be a little hard for your office to operate in some of these circumstances and instances, we have had officials that you are investigating still occupying public offices. Isn't that in any way interference in itself?
Well, Mubarak, I don't see that as interference because we rely on the law. What does the law say? The law has a provision for out-of-court settlements. The law has a provision for if a matter is going on within court and the culprit admits guilt, the person can have the matter sorted out, he can be asked to pay, and depending on the gravity or penalty of the offense. So we have got the mutual legal, well, not mutual legal assistance, we have got the out-of-court settlement through plea bargain.
Mm-hmm.
Plea bargain is the word. So when they take on plea bargain, then someone has admitted. And within the law, the person can be given the leverage to pay back.
Mm.
But depends on the gravity of the offense. We have instances where people have gone for plea bargain, paid back, and asked to leave the office.
Mm.
Because the Anti-Corruption Act says once somebody has been convicted of a corruption offense, that person is not suitable to occupy that office.
I'm looking at your investigations.
Yes.
With the people still occupying those offices.
Well,
are you not finding hard? Are you not finding it hard for you to keep investigating somebody who is actually being, who is still occupying
that office?
That
is the reason why when we start an investigation, you heard that last year we interdicted over 30 chief administrative officers. Why? To pave way for investigations. And it's on a case-by-case basis. There are cases which produce other cases. It becomes like an omnibus. Mm. I have gotten you, Mubarak, but the offense you have committed links into so many other people and unpacks so many other offenses.
Yes.
So that investigation cannot just take place within 6 months.
Mm.
So we keep extending this interdiction, extending, in order to give us sufficient time to conclude the investigation.
Is this what?
So why
people who are implicated in the Mabati saga are still occupying their offices?
When you look at the Mabati saga, it was prosecuted by the Director for Public Prosecutions.
Yes.
Yes. But you find that it's on a case by case. There are people who got the iron sheets and use it for the right purpose. There are people who got the iron sheets and use it for their selfish needs. So we have to cut a line. So the investigators have to look at that, and the prosecutors have to look at that. And that is the reason why you see the DPP dropped charges on some of those.
Mm.
So the law really has to be interpreted properly and also take into consideration also the moral aspect. Is this person suitable to occupy that office if he can take this for his personal benefit or gain? So for us as the Inspectorate of Government, we have been looking at the OPM. The OPM saga involving the entire relief.
Mm.
And I cannot discuss it here because it's a matter which is now in court.
Which
and
is
when
before
it is
court,
in
yes.
court, it's sub judice. I cannot begin.
So in other words, you stopped investigations because it's in court.
I am
is
saying.
Is that what you're saying?
The DPP prosecuted the Mabati saga.
Mm.
The Inspectorate of Government investigated the comprehensive relief aspect within the OPM.
Mm.
And the matter is now under prosecution in court.
Mm.
Yes.
So in other
and
words,
that is why I put
job.
A full stop and say, because it is in court,
you can't
I
say
do
anything.
Not want to discuss it here because in law it's sub judice.
Yeah.
Yes.
Dr. Patricia, we have to wind up this conversation, but there are so many other anti-corruption agencies
yes.
that has been established
mm.
To investigate different corruption allegations against public officials. Doesn't this certainly overlap with your office? And don't you find that some of your operations are being affected by these other agencies?
Well, Mubarak, it's a very good question, and it's also a delicate one because sometimes we have institutions investigating a matter and others coming to do the same, and you know this talk about many cooks spoiling food. This will add salt, another will add salt, another, and then the soup will be very... But we have a mechanism of work within the interagency forum where we have collaboration under the coordination of the Directorate for Ethics and Integrity, it brings together all these anti-corruption agencies. The Office of the DPP, the Auditor General's Office, the Inspectorate of Government, the State House Anti-Corruption Unit, and others together. Because I believe in complementarity. And when you look at each agency, again, each agency has got its mandate derived from the law. Others are instituted by the discretion, at the discretion of the president. Mm. But each agency contributes positively. So complementarity, at times we even have to do joint investigations. Joint investigations into some of these allegations. And we come up with real good prosecutable cases when we work in a collaborative approach. Although we have got each institution having its own mandate, like the IG, we have our mandate, we are independent. But where there is collaboration, we embrace the spirit of work together because we believe in complementarity. If I'm investigating a case and another agency X is bringing me more information, further and better particulars to enrich the evidence that I have, it is a thumbs up for that agency.
Many Ugandans seems to be losing, trust in public institutions because of what we are seeing. What needs to be done to ensure that trust is regained within the Ugandans?
We need to give Ugandans hope, like I began in the beginning. And in order to gain that hope, as an inspectorate of government, we have come up with several strategies in place. One is to promote transparency, accountability, and anti-corruption by ensuring that publicly we disclose information on actions, we share our reports, and like I said, our recommendations. We need to give feedback to the citizens so that we restore that hope and trust. So we also have the independence and autonomy in our operations. And if the public can see that we are independent and come with a clear position on a certain issue, I think we'll be able to build that trust and hope. Then professionalism and integrity in carrying out our work. We should strive to promote and demonstrate professionalism at all times, and integrity and adherence to the ethical standards and principles of fairness, impartiality, and also objectivity, the way we do our work. And as an institution, we are building a reputation of integrity. It helps us to instill that public confidence in institutions' ability to combat corruption. For instance, if I talk about integrity here, and tomorrow they see me compromising standards,
yes,
the public will definitely lose trust. So it's a call for the leaders. Mm-hmm. It's a call for the leaders to walk the talk, to model the way, to be the people they want others to be. And then I think it's important for us to also promote collaboration and public outreach and encourage whistleblower protection. There are times when a whistleblower reports a case, then you hear a whistleblower is victimized. How can we strengthen that whistleblower protection? When we have that whistleblower protection strengthened out there, then we'll be able to encourage as many whistleblowers to come and report cases of corruption to us. So by implementing these strategies, I think we hope to build and maintain that public trust as the inspectorate of government. And
Uganda,
we need to keep in
fact,
touch.
Has been so much painted as one of the worst countries, one of the worst corrupt countries, certainly, I may put it that way. Is this that bad? Have we got to that level,
Mubarak,
where honestly everything has literally failed?
Mubarak, I think it depends on the artist. Who is this painter? If it is Transparency International, I think we should not be derailed. Because like I told you in the beginning, local politicians, who are those painters? Remember, the politicians are doing their political game. It's about who is opposition, who is movement, who is... But we are here looking at what is good for the Ugandan. What should the citizen be consuming? Should they be consuming the political fights between opposition and the ruling party? No. This Uganda belongs to all citizens, whether opposition or whether NRM, all citizens must be able to enjoy to live in this country.
Are you saying that it is more of politics rather than actually the corruption that
the
you're
painters,
talking about?
The painters we are talking about basically is what we need to scope. If it is Transparency International coming up with a bad report on our country, I have told you about the questionable sources of data they rely on, yes? But what we need to do as an institution, I think, is to promote transparency, accountability, and anti-corruption, and keep giving feedback. If as an institution I'm able to tell the citizens about the progress in the war against corruption, if we are able to scope the enemy and say, fellow citizens, this is the enemy, and we are going to fight this enemy using these methods, they will embrace it. Because everybody wants a corrupt, free Uganda. Everybody is looking at national development. Everybody is looking at how they can grow and better themselves. Now, government has come up with programs like parish development model to benefit the citizens, but there are people who are planning to steal it. I have started monitoring these projects, and you have seen cases of people indulging in stealing money which should be used for bettering the citizens.
All right.
So I think for Ugandans, we need not to lose hope. We need to join the war against corruption. We need to report cases against corruption. We need to hate and shun corruption in order for us to have a corrupt-free Uganda. Yes.
Thank you so much, Dr. Patricia. And of course, it's been Dr. Patricia Chan Okiria, Deputy Inspector General of Government, talking about the progress of in the fight against corruption. You can join that conversation. It's already on our various social media platforms on X. The live link is there. You can, if you have actually missed the program, you'll be able to find it there. And of course, on Facebook and other social media platforms. We are continuing with this conversation about corruption in Rush Talk. Maizu Ramiti and Deputy RCC Rubaga Anderson Murora are coming up. Good morning.